Hello, everybody, and welcome back to our Fireside Chat series here on Observability at AWS. This is episode 2, and my name is Martyn Storey, and I'm a Solution Architecture Manager here in the UK. And I'm once again joined by Alex Liverson. Say hi and introduce yourself again, Alex.
Hi, my name's Alex. I'm a Principal Solutions Architect here at AWS, and I specialize in cloud operations and observability.
Thanks again, Alex. Thanks for joining us. So last time we explored the basics of observability. I really enjoyed that conversation that we had and its role in aligning with business outcomes. Episode 1 actually had about 1,000 views, so I was really pleased about that. Yeah. And today we're going to dive deep into metrics. It's great to have you back again, Alex. So let's get started.
Yeah, thanks, Martyn. I'm really glad to be here. Metrics are a really key part of observability, so I'm excited to discuss them today.
Excellent. So, Alex, again, let's get back to basics. You know, this is what we're here to do, is to sort of build up the view of what observability can provide. So can you explain what metrics are and why they are so important in the context of observability?
Metrics are really, they're quantitative data points that measure aspects of your system's performance or your application's performance. These could be things such as CPU usage, latency, error rates, request volumes, and they'll provide a clear view of a system's health, help you to detect performance issues, optimize operations, and meet business objectives. And I'm going to keep repeating that theme. Metrics give teams real-time insight and help them maintain reliability and ensure their services deliver the expected results. At the end of the day, these are business outcomes.
I'm really glad that you've aligned it to business objectives, Alex, because that's what it's all about. So I'm looking forward to sort of having that theme against this. So as you said, you know, our last session, we talked about aligning observability to business outcomes. So let's sort of dive into that. How does it align to business outcomes then?
So metrics are really central to this alignment. They allow you to monitor performance against key business objectives or against KPIs. For instance, metrics like maybe order volume or response time, they'll reflect the customer experience, which ties directly to business goals. And by monitoring these metrics, you ensure that your system or application meets these business expectations and outcomes that have been set as requirements from the business.
Meeting business expectations, absolutely critical, and we'll keep that as a theme moving forward for the rest of this this series on observability. So let's sort of dive even further. So what's important when it comes to deciding the metrics that we need to monitor, and how should organizations approach this? You've clearly done this many, many times with lots of organizations, so it'd be great to understand a little bit more about that.
Yeah, this is really important, and a lot of customers don't do this as well as I think that they should. And I'll start off with the way I think we should look at metrics, and I'd like to think of it as a pyramid of metrics. So at the top, you have your business outcomes, and these are the most critical. These are metrics like revenue, order completion, customer satisfaction. And below that, you get what are often referred to as the golden signals. And these are things like latency, traffic, error rates, and resource utilization or capacity. And these directly affect business outcomes. And then below all that, at the base, all these other technical metrics that support your infrastructure. And actually these can go into lower levels. So you might have CPU utilization, but beyond that, you could even have per core CPU utilization. But working from the top down helps ensure you're focusing on the impact of the technical metrics on business performance. So it enables you to understand the business impact. And it's much easier to go top down than it is to go bottom up. Imagine yourself looking at high CPU on one particular core. Well, how do you determine what impact that's having on the business, if any at all?
That's great. That's really interesting. I like the way that you went into that. And you know, two key comments: pyramid of metrics and golden signals. These are the two areas of focus that you have on metrics. Obviously, the pyramid of metrics is focused around business outcomes, back to that theme again. And the golden signals gets deeper and deeper into how we can correlate all these things together. So that's really, really interesting. So let's actually see in action. I really would love to see, a demonstration of how CloudWatch enables this. So let's kind of dive deep into CloudWatch. Let's help to track and understand these metrics. And I'd really like to see this in action. So Alex, could you show us a demo to the viewers, please?
Yeah, brilliant. So let me walk you through some key features in CloudWatch. Obviously, I'm not going to go through everything, but I'm going to go through some of the things that are going to help you with monitoring and managing your metrics.
So, Alex, what are we looking at here?
Okay, so here we're using something called Anomaly Detection. So this is available in CloudWatch metrics to enable you to see anomalies in your metric. So here we've got a line that represents API latency. So how long does it take to serve an API request? And then we've got a gray band at the bottom here, and that shows the expected value. Now, the way that this works is we're using a combination of machine learning and regression analysis to work out what the expected value should be. And then we project a band onto this graph that is the standard deviation from that mean value, from the average value that we expect it to be. And then we can see if we've got data points that are above or below this band. So as you can see here, we have four peaks that are well above this band, and these are obvious anomalies. And this would be something that we'd want to look at if we were diagnosing an issue.
Can I ask a quick question on it, Alex?
Absolutely.
So you say that the anomaly detection uses machine learning to detect. Can you sort of dive a bit deeper into that, please?
Yeah, so it's using a combination of machine learning and regression analysis. And it's basically using the last 2 weeks' worth of data and some additional parameters in the machine learning algorithm as well. To take into account things like the weekend and public holidays. And what happens is the machine learning algorithm is constantly being updated. And if CloudWatch detects that the new update is better than the old update, it will replace the model with a new model. So the model is constantly improving.
Oh, that's great. Thanks for that.
What we can also do is once we've got this, we can actually set an alert based on anomaly detection. So I've just clicked that bell icon there. It's brought me to a screen where I can create a new alarm, and I can choose either a static value, and this is where I would set like a static value, maybe at 2 seconds or something like that. But maybe I don't know what the expected value is. Or maybe I want to detect if there's a sudden peak in the middle of the night or at a weekend. That's when anomaly detection comes in really useful. So I've enabled that and I can choose outside of the band, greater than the band, or lower than the band. Now this is defaulted back to a value of 2, and that's the standard deviation from the mean. And that's not big enough here. So I'm going to go back to I think 50, and there we see I've got a better number, so it's only going to alert me when I hit those really high peaks. So that looks good, and then I could continue on with my alarm configuration.
Thanks for that. That's a really good demo on the alerting options. That's great about the anomaly detection. So what's next, Alex? What's you going to show me next?
So this is called Explorer, and it's just a simple way to aggregate metrics from a particular service together and aggregate those from across your account. So I'm going to select a pre-configured Explorer here. I'm just going to select an existing template, Lambda by Runtime. And what this is going to show me is a whole load of key metrics for my Lambda functions by different runtimes. So I don't have any Node.js 20 Lambda functions, but I do have some Node.js 14 Lambda functions. And here it's showing me the duration. And I've got others as well. Plus, I've got errors. And I've got some errors here in my Node.js 16 landers and my Python landers. So this is really useful for getting a combined view of different resources.
Is
There's
that a
another
view?
template. Go on.
Sorry to interrupt. Is that a view specifically on one service? You say it's focused on Lambda. So, what happens if you want to say view at some other metrics associated with this architecture?
Yeah. I've got one here for EC2 instance by type.
Right.
So here I can see different CPU instances by their size essentially. So T2 small, T3 medium, and I can see CPU utilization, disk read, disk ops, disk write, network in, network out. And I can just click this button and I could add them straight to a dashboard.
Can you stack them? Can you add metrics from one service to another so to see if there's a correlation of the spikes at the same time?
Yeah, the way you would do this is by adding them to a dashboard. And then you would add something else to a dashboard and you would see the correlation on the dashboard. And now we'll cover dashboards in a future video in more detail.
That's great. That's fantastic. Okay, I'm chomping at the bit for the next part of the demo. What's next?
Okay, so next we have multi-source query. So this is an example of where my data is not actually coming from CloudWatch, originally anyway. So this data is actually coming from Prometheus. So I've got the AWS distro for OpenTelemetry collecting Prometheus metrics from Apache web server. And then I'm using CloudWatch to interrogate those metrics from Prometheus. And as you can see here, we've got CPU load. This is just CPU load in percent of my Apache web server. Now, this is really useful if you want to use maybe some of the features of CloudWatch from a Prometheus data source. So I could set a CloudWatch alarm on a Prometheus metric. We have other options here. We've got Azure Monitor that we can look at. If I go to Azure, if I go to data source, I can see I've got Azure Monitor, I've got CloudWatch logs, Prometheus, and X-ray in there.
That's excellent. I mean, so your previous part of your demo was native metrics, and this is obviously third-party metrics. So that it just shows you the extensibility of CloudWatch.
Exactly. So this is really useful if I just want to get a few bits and pieces from other sources. And you can the important thing as well is you can create your own data sources.
Oh, interesting. So can you sort of dive a bit deeper into that?
Yeah, so this is done by creating a Lambda function, and we obviously provide a kind of hello world template for you to get started. And then you configure that to collect the data source. Obviously, it has to be in the right format as a time series, and then you're able to use that as a data source.
Thank you. So, what's next?
Okay, so here we're going to look at service level objectives or SLOs. So, Martin, you can see, I think, from this screen, which of my SLOs is unhealthy?
Well, it looks pretty clear to me. It looks pretty clear that it's the API response time is unhealthy at 97%. I can see that.
Yeah, and I have a goal of a one day rolling goal in this case of 99.9%. And I'm monitoring a custom CloudWatch metric here. So I'm monitoring, actually, it's the same thing that we showed before. It's API latency. So that's my service level indicator. And as you can see, I also have an error budget, which tells me how much time I've got left or how many errors I've got left before I start to fail against my SLO. So this is really nice. We can put these graphs onto CloudWatch dashboards as well. and we can easily see and alert when we're either breaking SLO or at risk of breaking SLO.
Right. So, just a quick question on this. I mean, coming back to the theme about business outcomes, is this really where we start to focus in on the business outcomes, looking at the SLOs?
Absolutely. And you can see here, these would normally be either business outcomes or they would sometimes be golden signals as well. So API response time is one of the golden signals because it's latency. So it would be either a business outcome or one of the golden signals usually. Another one here I've got is page load time. So I want my page load to be under 2 seconds. I'm attaining that at the moment. I've got 100% of my error budget remaining. You can see I've just got a couple of peaks there where I've gone above, but for very little time. So I'm not breaching the SLO, and I'm not using up any of my error budget either.
That's great. That's fantastic. Alex, that was awesome. It was really great to see that in action. And, that's definitely going to be the theme for our fireside chat, a combination of discussion and a combination of demonstrations. So let's wrap this up. I just want to sort of wrap it up by saying, why should companies invest in building a strong metric strategy?
Well, metrics give teams the ability to monitor their systems in real time, detect issues early, and ensure they're meeting, and this is crucial, both technical and business objectives. And by monitoring the right metrics, organizations can maintain both reliable services and ensure that their systems support business outcomes again, effectively. And it's worth spending the money and the resources to do this properly. I like to give a kind of story of if you're getting on a plane, and you're spending the standard amount on a ticket, you look to your left and you see a normal cockpit. Would you go, well, actually, I don't want to pay all this money for all this fancy flying equipment. I want to really get a cheap ticket. But then you walk on the plane, look to the left, and the pilot's not got any instruments. I mean, I know which plane I'd get on. I'd pay more for the normal flight.
That's a great analogy. I know when I walk onto a plane, I always go to the right. I'll let you know. But anyway, thanks, Alex. And thanks for everybody for watching. And if you missed our first part where we introduced the observability series itself, be sure to check it out. And stay tuned for more sessions where we'll be discussing logs and traces in more detail.
Yeah, thanks, Martin. And thank you, everyone, for joining us and looking forward to the next conversation.
Thank you. Bye-bye.